Hello students, hope you all are doing well, and today I welcome you all in the e-content for postgraduate classes of MSc Geology. And today I will be dealing with MSc previous first semester paper 1. The title of paper 1 is Biosystematics, Taxonomy and Evolution, and the topic I will be teaching today is International Code of Geological Nomenclature, which in short also known as ICGDN. I am Dr. Ankit Kumar Jain, Assistant Professor of Geology at Government PG College, Dhar. Now this is the description of today's topic, subject Geology, MSc First Sem, Paper 1. The title of Paper 1 is Biosystematics, Taxonomy and Evolution. And today's topic is International Code of Geological Nomenclature. For better understanding of this topic, basic knowledge of animal taxonomy is prerequisite. The basic knowledge of animal taxonomy includes primary knowledge about geological nomenclature and classification. And after completing this module, students will be able to understand binomial nomenclature. Students will understand binomial nomenclature, its general rules and applications. Students will also be able to understand uninominal and trinominal nomenclature. And students will understand international Code of Geological Nomenclature in detail, and this topic also includes various types of type specimen. So students will be able to understand the concept of type specimens. Our topic is International Code of Geological Nomenclature. For better understanding of the topic, I have divided the entire video lecture in four major parts, which are introduction of ICGDN, fundamental aim of ICGDN, principles of ICGDN and type specimens. The first part is introduction of ICGDN, in which we will discuss the basic information about ICGDN. The second part is fundamental aim of ICGDN, in which we will be discussing the significance of ICGDN. And the third part is principles of ICGDN, in which we will understand the core principles of ICGDN. And in part 4, we will be discussing the concept of type specimens. This is part 1, introduction of ICGDN. The full form of ICGDN is International Code of Geological Nomenclature. It is a widely accepted convention in geology that rules the formal scientific naming of animals, which means all the organisms considered as animals are named according to the rules of ICGDN. ICGDN is also known as ICGDN code, just to differentiate it with its publisher, which is International Commission on Geological Nomenclature, and that's why share the same acronym ICGDN. So we can say there are two full forms of ICGDN. First one is International Code of Geological Nomenclature, and the second full form of ICGDN is International Commission on Geological Nomenclature, which is actually the publisher of International Code of Geological Nomenclature. The second part of our topic is fundamental aim of ICGDN. So the fundamental aim of ICGDN is to provide maximum continuity in the naming of all animals by providing uniqueness, universality and stability. Here, uniqueness means the name of an animal taxon should be different from other animal taxon. And universality refers to the global acceptance of the name, which means if a geological name is valid, then it should be accepted worldwide. And the third point is stability. So once a taxon is provided with a valid geological name, its name should not be changed with time. Now this is the third and most important part of today's lecture, the principles of ICGDN. Before discussing the core principles of ICGDN, I will discuss the scope of ICGDN in short. The rules of ICGDN principally regulates how names are correctly established in the frame of binomial nomenclature. That means we will discuss the general rules of binomial nomenclature. And the principles of ICGDN also regulate which name must be used in case of name conflicts. Say for example, a same species is provided with two different names, or two different species are provided with the same zoological name. In such cases, which name must be used as a correct scientific name is regulated by the principles of ICJN. And the principles of ICJN also regulate how scientific literature must cite zoological names. Another important thing that zoological nomenclature is independent of other systems of nomenclature, for example, botanical nomenclature, which means animals can have same generic names as plant. For example, the generic name ficus belongs to banyan tree or fig tree, which are plants. The interesting thing is that the generic name ficus also belongs to fig shell, which is a gastropod animal. So we can say that animals can have same generic names as plants. Now we will discuss the core principles of ICJN. There are six basic principles of ICJN, which were first set out in the third edition of the code in 1985. These six principles are: first one is principle of binomial nomenclature, second one is principle of priority, the third one is principle of coordination, fourth one is principle of the first revisor, fifth one is principle of homonymy, and the last sixth one is principle of typification. We will discuss these six principles in detail in upcoming slides. Now, this is the first principle of ICJN, the principle of binomial nomenclature. According to binomial nomenclature, the name of a species is composed of a combination of two names, and as it is composed of two names, it is also called as binomon. And in this binomon, the first name is generic name and the second name is specific name or specific epithet. For example, for a species of human being, the zoological name is Homo sapiens, in which Homo is the generic name and sapiens is the specific name. In binomial nomenclature, both the names, the generic name and the specific name, must either be Latin or Latinized. Here, Latin language is used to provide maximum stability to the zoological name, as it is a dead language. In binomial nomenclature, the first letter of generic name should be in capital letter. As we can see, in Homo sapiens, the generic name is Homo, in which H is written in capital letters. The first letter of specific name should be in small letter. As we can see, in Homo sapiens, the species name is sapiens, and in sapiens, the S is written in small letters. During typing, these names should be italicized, which means we should type these names in italics. And when written with free hands, these names should be separately underlined. For example, if we write Homo sapiens with free hands, we should underline Homo and sapiens separately. In ICJN, trinominal and uninominal nomenclature are also used for zoological nomenclature. Trinominal nomenclature is used for subspecies level. So, the name of subspecies is composed of three names, and as it is composed of three names, it is also called as a trinomen. In this trinomen, the first name is generic name, second name is specific name, and the third name is subspecific name. For example, for subspecies of human being, the name is Homo sapiens sapiens, in which Homo is the generic name, sapiens is the specific name, and again sapiens is the subspecific name. And for taxa above the species, uninominal nomenclature is used. For example, the genus of human being is Homo and the family of human being is Hominidae. Here, Homo and Hominidae, both the names are single, and that's why this is called uninominal nomenclature. So we have discussed binominal nomenclature, trinominal nomenclature, and uninominal nomenclature. Maybe you people are more familiar with binomial nomenclature. So here I would like to clear that the term binomial nomenclature is more common in botany, and in geological nomenclature, the term binominal nomenclature is more common. This is the second principle of ICZN, the principle of priority, which was first formulated in 1842. According to the principle of priority, the correct formal scientific name for an animal taxon is the oldest available valid name. Here, we do not include invalid geological names. We only discuss among the valid geological names. For example, in 1815, George Ord named a species of pronghorn as Antilope capra americana. And later in 1855, John Edward Gray published the same species as Antilope capra antiflexa. Here we can say that the same species of animal is provided with two different names. And to solve these kind of conflicts, we follow principle of priority. Here, on the basis of principle of priority, the name Antilope capra americana takes priority as it was published earlier in 1815. And the name Antilope capra antiflexa become a junior synonym as it was published later in 1855. This is the third principle of ICZN, the principle of coordination, which states publishing a new geological name automatically and simultaneously establishes all corresponding names in the relevant other ranks with the same type. For example, publishing a species name Homo sapiens also establishes the subspecies name Homo sapiens sapiens. Here we can see the coordination between species name and subspecies name. Another example is publishing a family name Giraffidae also establishes the superfamily name Giraffoidea and the subfamily name Giraffini. Here we can see the coordination between family name, superfamily name, and the subfamily name. Now, this is the fourth principle of ICZN, the principle of first revisor. This principle supplements the principle of priority, that is, the first published name takes precedence. As we have seen in previous slides, that a single animal species was provided with two different geological names. And that conflict was solved by the use of principle of priority, and we choose the oldest available valid name as the correct scientific name for that species. But the principle of the first revisor deals with the situations that cannot be resolved by priority, such as two or more different names for a same taxon. For example, in 1758, Linnaeus established Strix scandiaca and Strix noctua as two different species of avis, but both the taxa later turned out a same species of snowy owl. And here comes the principle of first revisor. In 1931, Lonnberg acted as first revisor and selected Strix scandiaca to have precedence. So, after 1931, the name Strix scandiaca always considered as the more correct name for that species. Now, this is the fifth principle of ICZN, the principle of homonymy. First, we will understand what homonyms are. So, if two or more different animal species are provided with same geological name, then it is called homonyms. And according to principle of homonymy, the name of each taxon must be unique, which means a name that is a homonym of another name must not be used as a valid geological name. For example, in 1773, Drury established Cerambyx maculatus, a coleoptera, for a species from Jamaica. एंड लेटर इन 1775 फ्यूब्लिन एस्टेब्लिश्ड सिरेम्बिक स्मेकुलेटस फॉर अ डिफरेंट स्पीसीज फ्रॉम स्विट्जरलैंड. द प्रिंसिपल ऑफ प्रायोरिटी अप्लाइड हियर एंड डूरिस नेम गेट्स प्रेसिडेंस ओवर द फ्यूब्लिन्स नेम बिकॉज अकॉर्डिंग टू द प्रिंसिपल ऑफ प्रायोरिटी द ऑल्डेस्ट अवेलेबल जूलॉजिकल नेम इज कंसिडर्ड एज द मोर करेक्ट साइंटिफिक नेम फॉर ए स्पीसी. सो द ड्रूरीज नेम विच वॉज पब्लिश इन 1773 गेट प्रेसिडेंस एंड द फ्यूब्लिन्स नेम विच वॉज पब्लिश लेटर इन 1775 बिकम्स ए होमोनिम. दिस इज द लास्ट एंड द सिक्स्थ प्रिंसिपल ऑफ आईसीजीडेन, द प्रिंसिपल ऑफ टाइपिफिकेशन. अकॉर्डिंग टू दिस प्रिंसिपल एनी फैमिली ग्रुप नेम मस्ट हैव ए टाइप जीनस, एनी जीनस ग्रुप नेम मस्ट हैव ए टाइप स्पीसीज, एनी स्पीसीज ग्रुप नेम कैन हैव वन और मोर टाइप स्पेसिमेंस यूजुअली डिपॉजिटेड इन ए म्यूजियम कलेक्शन. सो वी कैन से ए फैमिली मस्ट हैव ए टाइप जीनस, ए जीनस मस्ट हैव ए टाइप स्पीसीज, बट ए स्पीसीज मे और मे नॉट हैव टाइप स्पेसिमेंस. वी विल डिस्कस द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ टाइप स्पेसिमेन इन डिटेल इन अपकमिंग स्लाइड्स. So we have discussed the principles of ICZN in previous slides, and now we will discuss the concept of type specimen. In this topic, we will understand the different types of type specimen. The first one is holotype. It is the single specimen on which the description of the species is based. Second definition is allotype. It is the specimen of the opposite sex to holotype. And the third definition is paratype. Additional specimens examined when the species was first described but not designated as holotype or allotype. To understand these three definitions more clearly, let us take an imaginary situation in which an author or a scientist who first described an animal species examined 10 animal specimens. And among these 10 animal specimens, he designated one as holotype. Now suppose if the scientist designated one male specimen as holotype, then a female specimen can become allotype. And if the scientist designated a female specimen as holotype, then a male specimen can become allotype. And in this case, one specimen become holotype, one specimen become allotype, and the rest of the 8 specimens will become paratype. The fourth definition is syntypes. If no holotype is designated, all the specimens that the author studied for the description of the species are called syntypes. Considering the same example, if the scientist did not designate any specimen as holotype among these 10 specimens, then all the 10 specimens will become syntypes. The next definition is lectotype and paralectotype. In the absence of a holotype, one specimen from syntype can be designated as lectotype and rest of the specimens as paralectotype. Again, considering the same example in which when the scientist did not designate a holotype, then all the specimens become syntypes. And now, among these syntypes, if we designate any one specimen as lectotype, then rest of the specimens will become paralectotypes. The next definition is neotype. If all type specimens are destroyed, a neotype that fits the description very well can be designated. For example, if holotype, allotype, paratype, syntype, lectotype, and paralectotypes are destroyed due to some reasons, then we designated a new specimen as neotype, which shows maximum similarities with the type specimens. And the next definition is topotype. It is a specimen collected from the same locality as the holotype, which means we collect the topotype from the same place from where the original author collected the original type specimens. I hope you all understand the topics discussed in this lecture, and for further reading, students can refer following links and books. Students can also refer the literature other than the literature mentioned here. These are the references which helped me a lot in preparing this lecture. So students, we have understood uninominal nomenclature, binomial nomenclature, trinomial nomenclature, principles of ICZN, and the concept of type specimen. And now we will try to assess our knowledge through some questions. So our first question is, what is or are the aim of ICZN in the naming of animals? Here the options are uniqueness, universality, stability, all of the above, and none of the above. And if we recall the previous slides, we can easily understand that uniqueness, universality, and stability all are included under the aim of ICZN. So the answer will be D option, all of the above. Our second question is, what is the full form of ICZN? Option A, International Code of Geological Nomenclature. Option B, International Council of Geological Nomenclature. Option C, International Council for Geological Nomenclature. Option D, International Council on Geological Nomenclature. And option E, none of the above. If we recall our knowledge, the correct full form for ICZN is International Code of Geological Nomenclature. The another correct full form of ICZN is International Commission on Geological Nomenclature, but that option is not given here, so the answer will be the A option, International Code of Geological Nomenclature. Our third question is, which of the following is not a principle of ICZN? According to the third edition of the code, which was published in 1985. The options of the questions are A option, principle of binomial nomenclature, B option, principle of priority, C option, principle of coordination, D option, principle of locality, and E option, principle of the first revisor. In principles of ICZN, we have studied 6 basic principles of ICZN, and among these 6 principles, we did not study principle of locality. So the answer of this question will be option D, principle of locality. The fourth question is, which of the following is used for the nomenclature of a species? Our options are A option, uninominal nomenclature, B option, binomial nomenclature, C option, trinomial nomenclature, D option, all of the above, and E option, none of the above. Here, the A option, uninominal nomenclature, is used for the nomenclature of taxa above the species rank, and binomial nomenclature is used for the species level, and trinomial nomenclature is used for subspecies level. So the correct answer for this question will be the B option, binomial nomenclature. The fifth question is, which of the following name is correct according to the principle of binomial nomenclature? Here we can see A, B, C, and D option all are seems to be same as Homo sapiens. But if we examined these options very carefully, we can find the correct answer of this question. In A option, the H of the generic name Homo is written in capital, as well as the S of the specific name in sapiens is also written in capital letter. So this is not a correct name according to the rules of ICJN. And in B option, Homo and sapiens are written correctly, but not italicized. And in C option, there is a dash sign between Homo and sapiens, which is not allowed in zoological nomenclature. And in D option, Homo sapiens is written correctly. So the correct answer for this question will be option D, Homo sapiens. The sixth question is, subspecies name is composed of A option 1 name, B option 2 names, C option 3 names, D option 4 names, and E option none of the above. As we all know, uninominal nomenclature is used for nomenclature of taxa above the species rank. For example, for kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, and genus, we used uninominal nomenclature. Binominal nomenclature is used for species level. And for subspecies level, we used trinominal nomenclature. So the correct answer for this question will be the option C, three names. A name of subspecies is composed of three names, which are generic name, specific name, and subspecific name. Our next question is question number 7. Uninominal nomenclature is used for A option species, B option subspecies, C option genus, D option family, and E option both C and D. Here, for species, we use binominal nomenclature. For subspecies, we use trinominal nomenclature. And for taxa above species rank, we use uninominal nomenclature. Genus and family, both the taxa are above species rank. So, genus is correct answer, as well as family is also a correct answer. So, correct answer of this question will be E option, both C and D. Our 8th question is, single specimen on which description of the species is based is called A option lectotype, B option allotype, C option holotype, D option paratype, E option paralectotype. Here, lectotype is designated from the same types, and second one is allotype. It is the specimen of opposite sex to the holotype. C option holotype. It is the single specimen on which description of the species is based. And D option paratype. Paratypes are additional specimens other than holotype and allotype. And E option paralectotypes. These are the syntypes other than lectotype. So the correct answer for this question will be C option, holotype. The 9th question is, a specimen of the opposite sex to holotype is called A option lectotype, B option allotype, C option holotype, D option paratype, E option paralectotype. Here, lectotype is designated from syntypes. Allotype is the specimen of opposite sex to the holotype. Holotype is the single specimen on which the description of the species is based. Paratypes are specimens other than allotype and holotype. And paralectotypes are syntypes other than lectotype. So the answer for this question will be option B, allotype. And now the last question is, a specimen collected from the same locality as the holotype is called option A, lectotype, option B allotype, option C holotype, option D paratype, and option E topotype. So lectotype is designated from syntypes, allotype is the specimen of opposite sex to the holotype, holotype is the single specimen on which the description of the species is based, paratypes are specimens other than allotype and holotype, and the specimen collected from the same locality as the holotype is called topotype. So the correct answer for this question will be option E, topotype. I thank you all for sincerely watching this video with patience. Thank you. Thank you very much.